Let me say that we've had an extraordinary number of people on this campus who are known to Ronald Reagan and who knew Ronald Reagan. But our guest tonight has some of the most incredible stories and some of the most interesting insights. His story, in many ways, is the story of Ronald Reagan. He's a graduate of Chico State University in California, which Ronald Reagan, if I might say, once confided in him, had he been mandated to attend a school in California, Chico State would have been it, because it reminded him of the sense of Eureka College. He comes from that sense of partisanship that Ronald Reagan knew, that ideological purity, but that sense of talking to everybody across the table to come to that conclusion, that respect for all kinds of folks. Ed Rollins, plain and simple, ran the most successful presidential campaign by electoral votes in the history of America, the 1984 Reagan-Bush re-election. Every single state in the Union, but for Minnesota, it's really cold, in that year embraced the re-election of Ronald Reagan, an incredible victory. And so today, Ed Rollins is a Fox News commentator. Ed Rollins gives advice through a corporate firm to folks. Ed Rollins is in the classroom. And Ed Rollins, thank the good Lord, is at Eureka College. We are so honored and so proud to have a close personal friend of Ronald Reagan's, the assistant to the president, the man who had a seat on every trip Ronald Reagan went on Air Force One, held for him anytime he wanted. The man who sat behind Ronald Reagan in the political meetings and the cabinet meetings, right behind Ronald Reagan. And the man who's about to tell us some incredible stories of insight. Please help me welcome the Honorable Edward J. Rollins.
Thank you so much, John. What a gifted politician you are. You ever think about politics? I'm a pretty good old campaign manager. I might be able to. And I want to appreciate you reminding me of Minnesota the morning after the election. I went in to see the president, and he said to me, not congratulations on winning 49 states. He said, what happened to Minnesota? And I said, Mr. President, we have to put nuclear waste somewhere, and they got all those lakes up there. He said, and he kind of looked at me like, we're really not going to do that, are we? But to show you the graciousness of Ronald Reagan did not want to campaign in Minnesota. He thought that was Walter Mondale's home state. He said Walter Mondale was a great American. He'd been a great vice president, he'd been a great senator, and obviously just had a very serious disagreement on philosophy. But he never once said a bad word about him, and he never once went into that state. Now, Mrs. Reagan wanted me to go in there full bore and bomb him out of the, because he kept going to California. And every time he'd go to California, all of her friends in Hollywood would basically say, when is we going to go to Minnesota? The president's got to come back out here. And she used to say to me, when are we going to open a headquarters in California? And I said, Mrs. Reagan, we open a headquarters. And she said, yes, but it's not in Rodeo Drive. That's where all my friends go. And I said, well, the next time we have a vacancy in Rodeo Drive where I can get a headquarters for less than $100,000 a month, I'd be happy to open a headquarters. But as much as I enjoy Mr. President Reagan, Mrs. Reagan was what helped make him the president. He would probably not have been president if it wasn't for her. And she was an extraordinary team, an extraordinary talent. As you started this beginning here, I'm reminded of a story. it's hard enough to basically come and follow someone as gifted as you to talk about. It's hard enough to come up here following President Arnold, who's basically my younger brother. I love that look, that beard, that bald head. Put on another 20 or 30 pounds, you'd be right there, babe. But to have to follow and they flash up the Reagan here in 1980, I had the misfortune once or twice of following Ronald Reagan in a speaking engagement. Now, why does anybody ever, Jim Baker was mad at me or something like that. And here's what happens. You have a big forum like this. You got 1,000 cameras in the back. We have one in the back here, but we have all kinds of cameras in the back. And so the president gives a magnificent speech, and then the follow-up act was me. And what happens when that occurs is all the cameras pack up and move out. While that's going on, about 1,000 of the people in the audience all get up and move out. The Secret Service comes up and takes the seal of the president off the podium, which is nailed for security reasons, and my mother and her 4 friends were all that was remaining. So there's obviously some tough acts to follow, and this is a tough act to follow. It was a privilege to have served one of the most unique men in history, and obviously his roots are here. This was the place where he found himself. This was the place where he found a security. This was the place he found a confidence. And I can tell you, having worked with a lot of political people, having worked for a couple presidents besides him, having worked for hundreds of candidates, ego is always something that's front and to the forefront. Ronald Reagan did not have an ego. Ronald Reagan had an extraordinary love for his country. I remember one time, there used to be a TV show on television called Kojaks. Some of you maybe remember it. Most of you are much too young to remember it, but it was a Telly Savalas, bald-head guy, kind of like us, Dave. A little more bald, but he was definitely good-looking and a real sex symbol, too. So we decide, big crime initiative, and we're going to New York to visit Manhattan South, which is just down from Times Square. And this was before Giuliani. The city hadn't been cleaned up yet. It was a pretty violent city. So we flew into New Jersey in Air Force One. We took the helicopters across. We got in the limousine. And we're going up 43rd Avenue, and there are a million people on the street. I mean, literally a million people stacked on the street to see the President of the United States. And I happened to be in the limousine with him because there were some political events involved. And you see this adulation. And I turned to him. He's not paying a bit of attention. He's waving a little bit here, a little bit there. And I just thought, this is a man who had adulation his whole life. And I said to him, I don't know what started, but in his lifeguard at Dixon, Illinois, or with being student body president here, or starring in 12 plays here, whatever it was, but he had always had adulation, and his ego was totally intact. So I said to him, does this ever get to you, Mr. President? He said, what get to me? I said, a million people out here cheering you. He said, oh, Ed, he said, just watch. He said, we'll get up here, someone will have some sign up there, screw you, Reagan. There'll be 12 guys flipping me the bird. And he said, that kind of always brings you back to the perspective. You know? And I sort of followed up with it, and I said, well, you know, it's like you don't ever get shook up when you have bad stories. He said, I was a B actor. He said, they never made movies around me. He said, they gave me the worst reviews anybody. He said, the New York Times, Washington Post can't even begin to touch what Photoplay did to me. The point I'm trying to make, and the stories I want to tell you, is to try and give you what the man was about. We know the great accomplishments he did as a nation, to our nation. But this was a man who, and again, I think it came out of the roots of here. He talked to me many, many times about Eureka College. But he had such a love for this country, and he had such a love for the values of the people of this country that obviously were formed here. He came from not a very stable family in the sense his father had a dysfunctional work and other problems, a wonderful mother, obviously. But this was a guy who basically grew up in a tough environment, probably the safest place he ever found in his early youth was right here. This is where he found himself. This is where he gave his speech. This is where he became a leader that obviously became a great leader. I don't think he ever saw this as his role model to go be president or governor or any of the rest of it. He just took a step a day at a time. And he said to me one time, we were in the helicopter and we're coming back, and the best ride in the world is not Disney E-Ride. It's coming across Washington, D.C. in the Marine One. And he was very tired. We'd been out campaigning all day. And I was sitting across from him, and we landed on the South Lawn and started to get up, and He had pictures of his ranch in his bulkhead. The place that he truly loved was his ranch. And his ranch, and some of you may have been up there, I mean, it's not exactly what LBJ had. It's not exactly Dallas. I mean, it's kind of a little shack with a beautiful view of the Pacific. But he loved that place more than anything in the world. So he said, I wish I was going there. And not knowing what to tell the leader of the free world, I just said to him, Mr. President, it'll all be worthwhile someday. History will be very kind to you. And he just sort of chuckled. He said, Ed, I'm going to be dead and gone when they write history. You know they're going to distort it anyways. He said, what I care about. He said, those young people we saw out there today, we have to give them the same opportunities we had. He said, here you sit with me on Air Force One, I mean on Marine One. My friend Paul Axall, the senator from Nevada, his father was a Basque immigrant sheep herder. His mother worked as a cook in a hotel. My father was a shoe salesman that couldn't hold a job very regularly. Your father was a shipyard worker, and here we are. That's what this great country's about. And we have an obligation to those young people out there to continue to make this country as great a place as it was. And I contrasted, and I'm not being partisan tonight or anything like this, I'm not quite sure the president we have today loves the country quite the same way, and maybe his experiences were different. But that love, that affection, that powerful speech, that standing up for the values of America was what made him great. There were two things that were overwhelming when we came into office. We had lived through the 444 days of our hostages being held. 52 hostages arrived on the South Lawn, having been freed the day he was inaugurated. And they came about 3 days later when they were released, and they arrived on the South Lawn. And I'll never forget the day I walked out there with thousands of others, and the president stood up there and he said, never again will this ever happen. Never again will anybody ever hold our embassy employees, and certainly not for 444 days. And that sort of set the tone. Unfortunately, 30 days later, he was nearly assassinated. Most people don't realize he came very, very close to dying. The story was never quite fully told, but he totally bled out. And I've talked to the doctors, I was there, and doctors told me that if he hadn't been such a healthy man, he would have died. Not only did he not die, 3 weeks later, he came back to the White House, went up and gave an extraordinary speech when everyone said, you can't do that. You can't go up there. You're not healthy enough. You have to stay in the hospital or stay in the White House for at least 4 or 5 months. 3 weeks later, he went up and gave this magnificent speech in which he pushed through his agenda items to rebuild the defenses of the country, to cut taxes. The whole premise of his agenda was in that early stage. He loved the military. You may recall him turning and saluting the Marine officers when he got off. That had never happened. The colonel who flew Jimmy Carter for 4 years said, Jimmy Carter never once said thank you to me. He said, this man, I got off the plane, off the chopper, and he saluted me. And one of his military aides said to Mr. President, you realize that you're the civilian commander-in-chief. Salutes are officers to officers, men to men. You can't do that. And he said, son, I'm going to be here for at least 4 years. Wherever that regulation is over the Pentagon, I advise you getting over there and getting changed real quick, because I'm going to salute. And I don't know what you're going to do to the commander-in-chief, because he saluted. But he set such a tone, and his number one priority was rebuilding the defenses of the country. Because he knew at that point in time the Soviet Unions were on the move, that they had spent enormous amounts of money invading Europe, Afghanistan, Latin America. And it wasn't popular. But when we came into office, we had Marines and sailors that were on food stamps. We had ships that couldn't sail. We had planes that couldn't fly. And we had a totally demoralized military after the Vietnam War and the period after that, in which obviously proper resources weren't going to do there. So he spent an enormous amount of his capital, put the country in debt, and he knew he was going to do that, but he thought that priority was so important. He basically wanted to close the chapter on the Vietnam War. He fought very hard to make sure that the Vietnam Memorial got built. It was a very controversial thing. We all have seen it now. We all think it's a beautiful memorial. It was a very controversial when it came, when the lines were drawn. And he called the Secretary of Interior, Jim Watt, who was in charge of the grounds and everything, and he said, I want it built. You know, make some adjustments if you have to, but I want that built. And I want to have a parade, a Vietnam parade. I want to take those soldiers and welcome them back and have them march down Pennsylvania Avenue. And you may recall when they dedicated the memorial, 1.5 million Vietnam soldiers, came many in their uniforms, many crippled, many in wheelchairs, and they marched down. He wanted to close that door. Shortly thereafter, in Memorial Day, when I was off running the campaign, we had the burial service for the unknown soldier of Vietnam. Because of the progress that we've made in DNA testing, what have you, there were only four military people they hadn't identified, but it was very important symbolically to bury one of the unknowns, and the unknowns have been there for World War I, World War II, Korea. Gigantic service, ceremony, Memorial Day, wreath bearing, the whole bit. Fortunately, in the modern age, we've discovered who that person was. It was a lieutenant who was killed early in the Vietnam War, and it's an empty tomb today, but this particular point in time is very critical. We went from there to the Air Force Academy, where he gave the commencement address. And it was this magnificent morning in Colorado Springs. And if you've been to the Air Force Academy, it's this extraordinary, extraordinary place. And there were 995 cadets. And he gave this extraordinary speech in which he talked about here. He said, when I was in Eureka College, he said, the pilots were flying in open cockpits when I went to school. And now we go in space. Now we basically have modern. And the progress that we've made, the critical part of that speech, he said, you are now warriors for peace. At the end of it, someone said, Mr. President, would you give the first salute to each of these cadets? And he turned to the superintendent, who was a two-star general, and he said, Superintendent, I'd like to do that. And the superintendent said, you know, there's 990-some-odd kids here. Take an hour and a half to do that. And he said, I don't care. I want to do it. Meanwhile, the advanced guys who had us on a very tight schedule to get to California were flying off, doing yelling, screaming, you know, blaming me because they thought it was one of my events that I was the one that encouraged the president to do this. The president stood there in the hot sun of the 995 students. About 100 of them are young women. One of the first big classes. One of the students there was the granddaughter of one of the great generals, one of the great bases Vandenberg is named after. And he stood there and he saluted each and every one, gave them each their first salute. Some of the little girls ran, threw their arms around him, some gave him kisses. Every cadet had their tears coming down their eyes. It was the most memorial thing that any of the President of the United States giving you the first salute. Over the last 30 years, I've often thought those were the officers who fought the wars that we've gone through the last time and are still fighting the wars. And the idea that they got the first salute from the President of the United States. So we're riding back in the car, and I said to him, Mr. President, those kids will never forget that. And he said, Ed, I didn't do it for those kids. He said, I did it for me. He said, the hardest day I had as president, and as you know, I was very reluctant about running for re-election, but the hardest day that I had was the day we went to Dover to bring home the 440 Marines that were killed in Beirut, or the 240 Marines that were killed in Beirut. And I knew that if I get reelected in this thing undertaking, somewhere along the line, I'll have to put more men and women into combat. And it's the hardest decision any president makes. And he said, I want to never think of them as statistics. I want to think of them as young men and women whose today I saluted, they saluted me back. And they're human beings, they're American heroes. And I always want to take care of them and always think of them in that terms. Now, I had tears in my eyes that day. And that's what the man was about. He didn't have to tell that story. That's me. I'm his guy, you know. But that's what Ronald Reagan was about. Ronald Reagan was a man who loved this country deeply. It was a long 8 years, some troubled times, some good times, extraordinary times. And I think he will truly go down as one of the great presidents. He never thought he was going to be a great president. He just thought there was sort of a destiny. And the most important thing was after he got shot, he said to me, God saved my life for a reason. I don't think the reason was for me to destroy the world. And we're at a point that people forget, and especially young people don't understand, that when we came into office, I talked about when President Obama came into office, the tough times, the difficult times, and I sort of chuckled. I said, we came into office, we had an economy that was destroyed. We had had this public humiliation with the Iranians holding our hostages. We had 25,000 nuclear weapons aimed at us from the Soviets. We had 25,000 aimed back, but we were on the verge, the brink of international war that would have destroyed the entire world. And he said, I don't think I was saved by the Lord to basically destroy the country. And he'd gone through one of these exercises that you go through, and they're sort of war games, in which, in the realities, you don't need 25,000 nuclear weapons to destroy the world. About 400 will basically, you'd be bouncing rubble around after that. And so he went through this drill, in which he doesn't play the president, someone else does. But it's sort of the Soviets do this, we do that, we do this, we do that. 10 minutes into the drill, he was dead. The president was dead. And the vice president basically had to carry on. And he never forgot it. He walked out of that, he was shaken by it. And he said, this is absurd. We've got to sit down and we've got to basically deal with these people because they can't want to destroy themselves. And obviously the man who came here, Mr. Gorbachev, was very critical to all of that. And we're now at a much better place. We don't talk about nuclear weapons. We do about Iran, but you know, Iran's going to get one. We still got 6,000. It wouldn't last very long. But at the end of the day, he was a man of destiny. He was a man who made the country a better place. And the last story I'll tell is, I'll never forget the day he went out of office when President Bush was inaugurated. And he went that day, and many of you may remember, they did this ceremony. Got in the helicopter and he circled. And he went above, circled the Capitol. And I thought to myself, I said, Mr. President, you'll never know how much you've done for this country. You'll never know how much you've done for this country. And if he ever would have had the Congress that we have today or other things, there'd been so much more that he could have done. But with a Democrat-controlled Congress, he sat down with them, he made peace with them, he did many things, and he was a great role model. And I come back to the fact that it all started here. That first speech he gave on that chapel stage when he was probably 18 years old gave him the confidence that he'd go out and persuade and he can influence people. And the presidency for him was an ability to go out and communicate his thoughts and his ideas that he had developed over a 25-year period. I mean, he'd gone from being a very liberal young student probably when he was here to being one of the great conservative leaders of the world. And I think to a certain extent, somewhere in the 775 students that you have here today, you're going to have many more great leaders. And you've got to get the foundation, not from Yale, not from Harvard, but right from here. And I assume that now that you've got 775 and 7,000 of your alumni, you're going to have a club right next to the Harvard-Yale Club there in New York, which will be good. We can go visit that. So, and maybe the Chico State guys can go over there too. I used to tell him, when he told me about Eureka College, he said, you know, I love my school. He said, nobody knows where it is. I said, well, Mr. President, when I first came to Washington, I went to Chico State College, and I'd go to these dinner parties. I was there in the Nixon administration, and, you know, all these anti-Reagan Rockefeller Republicans, what have you, nice people, but they would say, where'd you go to school? And it's the only place I've seen in the world that everybody talks about where they went to school, Harvard, Yale, prep schools, this. And they come around to me and they'd say, where'd you go to school? I say, Chico State College. And they go, oh, how quaint. And someone said to me, isn't that the prison? I said, no, that's Chino State College. Chico State's where you go to school. Well, every day, what Ronald Reagan did, when he got in office, it wasn't the Yales and the Harvards that were in the country. It was the Eureka College. It was the San Jose States. It was the Chico States. It was the Penn States. It was the other side and the kids that basically knew the foundations of this country. And I think that's why he ended up being such a great president. It's a pleasure to be here. I'm going to answer, I guess, a few questions here. But it's an honor for me to come here and to see where he talked about this place so many times. And this was such an instrumental part of him. This was his foundation and his core. And I think each and every one of you that are students here, those of you who are faculty here, have so much to be proud of. And the values that we have here are the values that we have to make sure. As I have watched this nasty campaign go on, and my side's as nasty as any side, I think Ronald Reagan would be in despair. This was a man who basically, the 11th commandment was, you don't speak ill of your opponent. And you see the stuff going on today, and somehow it has to stop. And everyone who's grabbing for the Reagan mantle, I want to say Ronald Reagan would throw your ass out the door if he knew what you're doing. And it's just so. We need to be about ideas, not about criticisms. And at the end of the day, the one thing that he always said to me is we're all Americans. Maybe Republicans, maybe Democrats, maybe Christians, maybe Jews, maybe Muslims. But each and every day, we're all Americans, and we have so much to be proud of. Thank you.
can test.
You know, I went to your beautiful library today, and I thought to myself, I went to the library.
Chico State. Big building there. I was graduated in the upper two-thirds of my graduating class. maximum cum laude. I had a lot of fun.
Well, I'm glad you were in our library today.
Thank you. Thank you. Beautiful library. I could actually study in there. Uh-huh. I had to get to be 73 before I could study in a library, but I could probably study in that library today.
You're in the Mark R. Shankman Reagan Research Center, which is one of our most generous Reagan Society members gave us for the centennial. And there on the steps of that library is where Ronald Reagan dedicated the library in 1967. And from that speech comes one of my favorite Reagan Eureka quotes, which is that the national purpose of our country is to unleash the full talent and genius of every individual. Does that sound like Ronald Reagan to you?
It does. And I'll tell you, I first met Reagan as a sit-up. I was a party boy, football player, boxer, student body president, and barely part-time student at Chico State. But Reagan appointed me as a chairperson of a faculty student study unrest on the campuses. Our campuses were exploding when he became governor, as you might remember. And he talked to me about, we were sitting in the governor's office, and he said, I led a student protest. He said, it was about classes being cut and what have you. He said, but there was no violence. He said, there's nothing wrong with students protesting. He said, that's the American way, but there's no violence. And the problem today is that these kids think nothing of the violence and being very derogatory to each other. When he got elected governor, half the faculty in California said, we're going to Canada. We're leaving, we'll leave to destroy. I mean, Canada would be so overloaded by the people that promised they were going to leave when Ronald Reagan got elected. It would be twice the size of Texas, but it didn't. And I think to a certain extent, he raised educational standards in California. He basically, as a member of the board and what have you, by the end, California put more money into higher education than ever had before. His presidency was all about young people and education. And I think to a certain extent, he firmly believed in that, thought this was very important, made commitments to come back here. And there are a lot of myths about Reagan. Reagan was a very smart man who basically studied every single day of his life. He thought on paper, he'd write things out. Some of the most brilliant documents you'll ever see. And he evolved. He was a lifelong student, and I think that catalyst all came right from here. He read. He wasn't the most political man in the world. He didn't care about the politics like other people that have had that office do. He cared very much about the people, and he always knew where the body politic was. I told you the funny story today. Dick Wortham, who was his pollster, a wonderful man, who had been governor of California, and his presidential pollster, a very important player. And people like myself that love polls, and I was probably looking at more polls than anybody in America, Wortham always insisted he went in and briefed the president on, we had a poll about every 3 weeks, what was going on in the country. So I walked in one day afterwards, and the president said to me, well, what do you think of Dick's polls? I said, well, I haven't seen it. Dick insists on briefing you first, and then he briefs us afterwards. I haven't seen a copy of it. So he bends over and pulls the poll out of the garbage can. He says, here, you can have my copy. And he didn't care about those things. I mean, what he cared about is he knew where the body politic was. I mean, he probably paid attention when the briefing was going on, but it was not like I got to do this because of the polls. And I can tell you, as his political advisor, I used to say to him, Mr. President, politically we have to do this. And he'd say, Ed, we didn't come here to do politics. So I have to think of another way of getting at the same point. But he was not, it was not about politics. It was about what's in the best interest of the country. And he didn't go in there with the idea he was going to be a two-term president. And he really didn't want to run for a second term. And Mrs. Reagan definitely didn't want him to run for a second term after he was shot. But he just thought there was so much more to do. And obviously, you have this wonderful peace garden here, and Mr. Gorbachev. If he hadn't run for a second term, none of that would have taken place, in all likelihood. So he served the country very ably, not just for one term, but after being shot, after lots of illnesses and what have you, a second term. And basically, I can tell you, to the last day he left there, he was working hard to make this country better than it ever was before.
Good. Well, Some of you have submitted excellent questions. Actually, all of you submitted excellent questions.
I just have to give an excellent answer.
He is excellent answer. First question, I'm doing these like Ronald Reagan did. He would shuffle his note cards and then it would surprise him as it came up. So we'll surprise ourselves. 1984 reelection campaign, who thought of the theme Morning in America?
I had put together, it's a great story. I was asked to go run his campaign in March of 1983, and so I left the White House on October 17th to set up the campaign. And people don't realize or don't remember, Ronald Reagan was trailing Walter Mondale and John Glenn for literally a year. So the day he asked me in March if I would go run his campaign, I think we were at 38%, 37% approval rating. I said to Lee Atwater, who was my deputy, the hell did I do? Why am I going to have to go? I'm going to be the first guy to take an incumbent president and run him in the ground. Anyways, to make a long story short, we went out, set the campaign up, the economy came back. The Morning Again in America was we very serious negotiations were going on with the Soviets at this point in time. And my initial response was I wanted to run a campaign reinforcing the things we had done, which is greatest thing I think he had done was rebuild the defenses of the country, and I wanted to talk about that. So I decided what I really did is I created a great organization. We had public money. It was a publicly financed campaign. It was the first publicly financed campaign post-Watergate that we didn't have a primary challenge. So I took the money in the primary, and I went out, and I registered voters. And we took 7 million formerly Democrat and the Republicans, and we created a 50-state organization, and I created 600,000 volunteers. I didn't have all the fancy things that Axelrod and those guys. We had yellow pads and phones, not cell phones, just phones, and a lot of very dedicated people. So it was really a volunteer-driven, and great things were happening. People started to feel good about themselves again. We had the wonderful Olympics. The economy was coming back. So I almost made the most fatal mistake anybody could do dealing with Ronald Reagan. I thought, maybe I don't need an ad campaign. You spend half your money in doing advertising, and I didn't think ads necessarily move. We were on TV every night. People knew what Reagan was doing. And finally, this guy who had been Reagan's longtime consultant in California, Stu Spencer, said to me, Ed, don't forget who your clients are. They don't understand all this organizational stuff, and they don't understand 600,000 volunteers. They and their friends are all movie stars. They want to see pictures, and they want to see pretty pictures, and they weren't very happy with the first gang, the 80 campaign. So I went out and put the best advertising guys in the world together, and they all wanted to work for Ronald Reagan, and they left the big agencies, Hal Reiney's, and it was probably the best advertising ever done, won all kinds of awards, spent a lot of money on it, very high produced, and it was this theme of Morning Again in America, and it was sort of building on making Americans feel good about themselves again. And everybody says it was Morning Again in America was the tag. That was the first commercial we did. But the tag was leadership you can trust. And when we finished the campaign, you know you've done a good job, and you look at the polls and you say, why did you vote for Ronald Reagan? They said he was a leader we could trust. You knew that the campaign had worked. And in fact, they'd won 59% of the vote in 49 states, also was a good indicator that it worked. But we wanted to basically convince the American public that things were good and that they were getting better, and we sort of captured the spirit of the Olympics and the whole bit, and that's what Morning in America was. Now, we didn't say it was Morning in America and you didn't have to get up and go to work. We said basically we're back, the darkness is gone, and it was extraordinary. And if any of you ever seen the ads, they're fabulous ads, and as I said, they won every kind of award. And these advertising guys who were wonderful, I mean, these are big-time, multi-millionaire ad guys who ran every kind of commercial in the world. And they got to go in with Ronald Reagan, and they had this first meeting with him. And he walks in the room, and they're all the president. And Reagan is so handsome and so well built. I mean, he's just like, you know, still has a V, and there's no room he's ever in. I only saw one man ever overshadow him, and that was Pope John Paul. Of course, he had the white outfit on, all that kind of stuff, and the halo. but everybody else, you know, Reagan always was, I'm the host, of, you know, the only one on the stage who could ever kind of compete with him was Brian Mulroney, who was the Canadian Prime Minister, who was also a big Irishman. They loved it. They loved each other. But so they walk in the room, and Reagan says, here I am, guys. I'm the soap. You got to go sell me. And they just loved him, and they thought he was magical, and they basically you know, just created this extraordinary ad campaign. nothing negative, never ran a negative ad the whole time. And basically, and the premise of our ads were, unlike today where you've got 90 million ads that you don't want to watch, the premise of our guys, Phil Dusenberry, then all the Pepsi stuff, and Hal Reiney, who was the golden voice behind all of that, is you want people to want to watch your ads. You want the ads to be so interesting that when they come on, you want to stop and watch them. And that's what we did. It was a great, great campaign. And we thought it would change the standards of advertising. We thought we'd get away from all the negative crap and what have you. And it took about one campaign for that to go back to the old style. So.
What was the happiest day and saddest day of the President Reagan's presidency?
Well, I always say that the happiest day, of the president has two happy days. One is the inaugural day, and the other is when he's dedicating his library. I think Reagan had many, many great moments. I think welcoming the hostages home. I think the saddest day was, as I said earlier, going in and recovering the bodies of the 244 Marines. PX Kelly, who's been here, was the Commandant of the Marine Corps. It was just, we had cut a very bad deal, and it was a very controversial decision to go. Then the bad deal was we were there as part of a joint peacekeeping venture, and we took Marines and we let them have bullets in their guns. Literally, the security, they couldn't have their guns loaded. They gave us the worst spot. They put us in the airport where we were downhill. It was one of these tragedies we never thought was going to happen. And obviously, it was a dramatic. And it sickened him to such an extent. I think it almost made him not run for reelection. It was a very late decision he made. I left the White House October 13th, and I had set this campaign up in the White House. And I went in my last day, and I said, Mr. President, you have not told me yet you're running for reelection. And to the best of my knowledge, you've not told anybody else in this White House. And I've asked everybody from Nancy Reagan to Maureen Reagan to Jim Baker. Now, I'm leaving my big office here. I'm leaving my assistant to the president job, my car and driver. And I'm going over there, and I'm going to look like a damn fool if I go out and raise $50 million for you, and you ain't coming. And he goes, oh, Ed. Expecting once again, he's going to say yes. He said, Ed, it'll make me feel really good that if I do make this decision sometime in the near future, I'll know you're over there ready to go. So I turned to Lee Atwater, who's my deputy, and I said, what's happening here? We gone out setting this thing up? And so finally in January, he told us he was running. So
there was a genuine concern among you political types that Ronald Reagan was not going to run for reelection.
Absolutely. We announced 11 o'clock on a Sunday night.
So. What factors, next question, led to the 1984 election landslide for President Reagan after the 1982 midterm elections where Republicans lost a lot of seats?
We had won 50% of the vote in 1980. We had a landslide victory, but we didn't have a real big majority. We also had John Anderson running. We had a third candidate. I think what led to the landslide was we went out and converted these Southern Democrats, in particular, in the voter registration. As I said, we registered 7 million new voters, and I think we got 8 million new votes in the difference between the two elections. And once we registered them, we captured them. We basically had we took one of the volunteers, made them a captain. Here are the 10 people we just registered. You're to go to them. It really was a grassroots campaign, very much like what Obama, without all the bells and whistles. And most people say to me it was the greatest campaign, not because I ran it, but it's the greatest campaign they had ever been involved in. It was a positive campaign. There was no fighting among us staffs in the White House, which traditionally occurs. Reagan himself was a happy warrior. He loved the campaign. And I think it kind of restored his faith in the American public. It just ended up on a high note. The low note was the day after the election, not to be disparaging, this is a true statement. Jim Baker, the day after the election, we're in California, we have this Jim Baker, a very talented man, his chief of staff, and obviously you've honored him here. There's 2,000 reporters covering this worldwide with the Century Plaza Hotel, and there's a White House press corps that basically is about 200. So I'm doing the big international press conference at like 9 o'clock. And one of the White House guys came out of the breakfast with Baker, and he said, Baker just said you didn't get a mandate and that we didn't win the congressional seats we needed. I think we picked up 18 congressional seats. And so the first question to me, of course, is, Mr. Rollins, you just won 49 states, Mr. Mr. Baker said you didn't want a mandate. I said, well, I guess his standards are a hell of a lot higher than I am. I guess we had to win all 50 to have a mandate as far as he's concerned. But unfortunately, by that afternoon, Tip O'Neill and Tony Coelho were the leaders of the Congress were out there saying, well, they didn't get a mandate. Jim Baker said they didn't get a mandate. They didn't win the congressional seats. And we're right back to ground zero. I mean, you can't take away the victory, but it was much harder than it would have been. And equally as important, the one thing that frustrated me as the strategist is I wanted a second term agenda. We sort of run out of the agenda items in the first term, and so we ran a campaign we ran a feel-good campaign just simply because Stockman and Baker and these guys just couldn't, they didn't think it was all going to make it add up. They all got frustrated and they all left, but at the end of the day, I wanted to go out and argue that the defenses of the country were important. We had this great ad campaign that these guys did, and it was a brilliant campaign, and I discovered later it was because we were in the negotiation. What the ad was, you see these guys playing volleyball. You see the ocean in the background, and the camera pulls back, and it's an aircraft carrier, guys in their shorts. And the tag is, thank you, Mr. President, we're now prepared for peace. Guys playing softball, you know, and running down the bases in shorts and what have you, pulls back, and there's tanks and jeeps saying, thank you, Mr. President, we're now prepared for peace. And I thought that would have been a brilliant reinforcement campaign and what have you, but the White House didn't want to do that. And I discovered later that it was because they were in negotiations with the Soviets, and they didn't want to remind the Soviets that we'd spent this money building up, which I thought would have been a very important tactic, but I wasn't running a whole show, so.
What's your favorite memory of Dutch?
Oh, I had so many favorite memories of his that it's hard to, you know, we had a lot of personal moments. We spend more time talking about movies than we ever did about politics. He was a nice man. I think the key thing that you just would, I mean, I told you the story this morning. I had a total screw-up. After I was named the top job, I was Lynn Nofziger's deputy the first year, and I became the assistant to the president in November of 81. I had been very close to Maureen Reagan, who was talking about running for the Senate in California. No one wanted to run because they wanted to run for Congress, not for the Senate. And Pete Wilson and a lot of Reagan's friends were in that race. So I was interviewed by the Sacramento Bee to sort of do a profile on the hometown boy who's now going to run the political operation at the White House. And she had wanted me to run her campaign, so the first reporter asked me this question about Maureen, and I said, you know, I can't talk about that. It's just, he said, no, that's totally off the record. He puts the book away, and he said, I'm not going to quote you or anything like that. So, of course, the next day he puts in there the things that I said about Maureen, which weren't very diplomatic. She, of course, hammered the president and then first lady all weekend. I had to go visit the president, go to the woodshed, as they call it, Monday morning. I walk in the room expecting to get fired, which I obviously could have been, justifiably. The president says to me, Ed, we both have lots of friends in that race. I'll make you a deal. I won't talk about any of them if you don't talk about any of them. Puts his arm around me, walks me to the door, and out I go. Now, for a guy like that, you just, you know, when you think you've just looked in the abyss and jumped in, and he saves you and makes you feel good, you'll go kill for him. And I told you the story. My parents were, father's a shipyard worker. They'd been longtime Democrats. They shifted finally, as my father said, not because of you, because of Jerry Brown and Tip O'Neill. And I had a stroke a week before the 92 elections, and a bad stroke. My mother and dad are in the hospital room with me, and my mother said, take that gown off and put your pajamas on. I'm sitting like, you know, please leave me alone, Mom. Pretty soon the president walks in. So
the president comes to visit you.
The president comes to visit me in the hospital and spends an hour with my parents. And he sits them down in the corner, and they just have this wonderful conversation about movies and all the rest of it. And talking about both of them having been Democrats, and Reagan telling the story about, I didn't leave the Democratic Party, it left me, which is, of course, was my father's feeling. So it was just, but he literally spent an hour with my parents. I was totally irrelevant. He knew I was breathing over in the corner of the bed. But after that, that kind of attention to grieving parents who were worried about their oldest son dying and comforting them just was what Ronald Reagan was about. And to me, you know, I didn't know whether I'd ever get out of that bed, didn't know whether I was ever going to recover from my stroke, which obviously I did, and never expecting to work in the White House again. But I said to myself, if I ever can get back up again, I will do anything for that man. And needless to say, I recovered, went off to run his campaign, and the rest of it's history. So.
Did you write this question?
No.
This question is, can you share your experience of having a beard while serving in the White House?
Mr. Chancellor, I grew my beard. I was an appointee in the Nixon administration. I had been a Reagan guy, but I was the Assistant Secretary of Congressional Affairs in the Reagan administration. And part of the fascination of that is 6-8 weeks into the administration, I got detailed to the White House to be part of the Watergate team, which became part doing Hill work for President Nixon during Watergate was like my PhD in political science of how not to do it. Became very close to the president. But so when Carter won, beat Ford, we all the presidential appointees got a week, 2 weeks notice. So I said, put on my cowboy boots, my jeans, figured I was going back to California, started growing a beard. And I said, I'm going to let the beard grow until, whatever. I didn't realize quite that point in time that we were going to defeat Carter 4 years later and I'd be in the White House. By then, no one knew who the hell I was because I'd had a beard for 4 years and my whole public profile was with a beard. So I go into the White House and I have a big, big beard, big, full, like your beard, bald-headed, sloppy dresser, just Nancy Reagan's perfect kind of guy that she wants to have in her White House. And my partner is Lynn Nofziger, who had been in the press secretary, who basically, she never quite had fondness for him because of his attire. And we both managed to get picked by Washingtonian Magazine as the worst dressed man in the administration in 81-82. Which is important, and it's like one day, Women's Home Daily or Women's Daily kept calling me the reporter for that, and I kept saying, and Lynn came out and he said, you got to talk to women. I said, what the hell does Women's Daily have to do with? He said, it's Mrs. Reagan's favorite reading, and she wants you to talk to them. So I became sort of the source of Women's Daily. So any big political secrets that came out, it wasn't the Washington Post, the LA Times, it was Women's Daily that whatever the hell it's called. It's, I'm sure some of you in this room know what it is. It's the, sort of the fashion thing. So I kept my beard. It was more trimmed today because I had not because she told me, but a barber told me, you want to lose 25 years off your life, take all that gray crap off your face. You're younger than me, so you can.
I have to ask, but was it a bearded man that asked that question, or?
It may have been. It may have been. I think it was your marketing. I think it was your marketing guy over here.
Professor Harry Fisher, ladies and gentlemen.
Harry Fisher.
Very good question, Professor. Our professors ask good questions.
They do.
Okay, one more. We've got too many questions, and we're gonna come down to the final question here. And afterwards, Mr. Rollins will be around for a little while, and you can come up and ask him. But just reading this one in case it's better than the final question. Very good. Related to the final question. Why are so many people invoking Ronald Reagan today, so many years later? What do you make of it? And in asking that question, what do you make of this climate today?
First of all, I used to get asked this question. And I teach a course on the presidency, and my background is political science. And people said to me, how is Reagan going to be rated? This is when he was going out of office. And I said, he followed five failed presidencies, failure being defined by starting with the assassination of Kennedy, Lyndon Johnson, not being able to run for re-election, defeat of Nixon, defeat of Ford, Jimmy Carter, defeat of Jimmy Carter. And I said, so he gets two terms, two landslides, and so he's like a giant redwood tree sitting among the pines. Now, if all of a sudden the next three or four presidents come along and they're every bit as good as him, then he's one of the giant redwoods, but not the only one. Well, as we know, and no disrespect to George H.W. Bush, who got the third term, we've not exactly had sterling presidencies, so Reagan is giant. And now the historians and the political scientists and others have gone back and reflected on the things that he did. And you still have the critics and you still have those who will never give him credit and you'll still have those who blame him. Nobody in Eastern Europe will blame him and no one who's ever dealt with him and no one ever who served in the military will ever feel that way. And the vast majority of Americans will never feel that way. But I think they thought Reagan did it by accident. They said, he wasn't that smart. Well, he was plenty smart. I can tell you, I was in every meeting with him for years. He had a near photographic memory. He read everything. He made great decisions. He could make decisions quick. He basically had core beliefs that he wasn't going to change on. He believed the defenses of the country were important. Number one priority, even if we couldn't make it, we had to rebuild. If we're going to deal in a position of strength, we could deal with the Soviets. If we didn't have a position of strength, we would never deal with the Soviets from an equal position. So my sense is what he did to this country was dramatic. He changed the economic status. All my friends on Wall Street, who a lot of them are liberal, I said, how would you do paying 70% tax instead of what you do today that's still too high? He made the presidency work because he made people feel good about themselves again. People, when we were elected to office, and many young people understand this, people thought the job of the presidency had become too big and that one man couldn't do it. When Reagan was there, they thought he could do it part-time, or did it part-time, which he obviously didn't. But there was sort of this perception by many in the mainstream media that that he wasn't the smartest guy in the world, that he had a lot of good staff guys. And the point I make is the staff changed dramatically. I mean, he ended up having 5 chiefs of staff. I think he had 4 political directors. He had 7 national security advisors. Every position changed, and he still kept the ball moving forward. He was the man who set the tone. He was the man who basically knew what he wanted us to do. And the way he would function is he would say, it's like when I ended up, he asked me to run the campaign. I said, Mr. President, tell me, is there anything that you want? I mean, I obviously know how to run campaigns, but this is a presidential campaign. This is your campaign. He said, Ed, he said, I made movies for 25 years, and I always had a good director. And when I had a good director, you're my director. So you tell me what you want me to do. I'll tell you if I don't like it. I'll tell you that I'm not going to say something that I don't believe. But I'm giving you the responsibility to run the best campaign you can. Well, that's a heavy burden. And you walk out of there, and I had such a love affair for him and everybody else that I wasn't going to screw up. I mean, I was not going to screw up. I was going to do everything I could to make sure that he got the victory he deserved. And then he went out and performed in a way that was just magnificent and got stronger as the campaign went on. He had one bad debate, and people forget. They all say, well, what about that debate? Incumbent presidents don't debate well. They don't have to debate with anybody. Nobody sits on a stage. And Walter Mondale had 57 primary debates up to that prior to that debate, I mean, this very contested thing. And he'd been vice president of the United States, and he'd been a U.S. senator. Reagan came back the second debate, and the most wonderful thing of that night, the first debate, which we knew it wasn't good, and we're going to go in the spin room and do all the stuff that you do in a spin room. And he said, no, nobody goes in there. He said, I blew it. I lost it. I wasn't ready for it. I'll be ready for the next one. And obviously he was. I think people have now come and reflected on him and looked at him. And again, making Americans feel good about themselves and making them feel good about the country was the most positive thing they could do. He was an honest, decent man, created no scandal. As I was telling you today, he never took his jacket off in the Oval Office. Obviously, the president that followed him did things other than took his jacket off. But but at the end of the day, not meaning George W. Bush, not H.W. Bush. And I think, unfortunately, President Bush, who got the third term, and Ronald Reagan was about 3 major things: building up the military, raising money for the military, lowering taxes, and getting government off the backs of small business, particularly small business. Bush cut defense, raised taxes, basically started re-regulating again, and couldn't understand why he lost the base. And he did. He lost 29% of Republican votes. And lovely man, great vice president, good president. People reflect back on his sort of finishing a lot of it. But he had lost that Reagan coalition.
Well, we are honored by your insights, fascinating stories. For those of you who are political junkies, I suspect we could go to midnight, but we're not going to.
You asked one part. I think, in fairness, what's happening today? Want me to answer that?
Yes.
Okay. If I would have sat here a year ago and said that there's a socialist member of the Senate from Vermont is going to give Hillary Clinton a real run for your money, First, you wouldn't ask the question. Secondly, I wouldn't have said it because I wouldn't have believed it. And third, I'd have been laughed out of the political structure. Bernie Sanders is giving her a race. I think she still ends up being the inevitable nominee, but she's going to be tarnished and damaged, and there's a real credibility gap. And young people, which is the key to the Democrat coalition of both Obama's elections, it's young voters that gave them majorities, may not be there, and we have an opportunity to go get that. On our side, going back to the points of, I was making earlier about Reagan never saying, this is WrestleMania. Donald Trump basically is the epitome of, and if any of you are Donald Trump fans, I'm sorry, I'm going to give you my point blank. And I know Donald very well. Donald Trump basically has done things that are very damaging to the political process. And there's a certain segment of the society that's very unhappy with where they are, and they think he can basically be a leader and he can do things that are not politically correct and all the rest of it. But he's also going to do things that are very damaging to the party long term. And when you look at demographics, this society is going to basically, in the next 10 to 15 years, is many states are not going to be white majorities. Mexican-American voters are going to be very important. Asian voters are going to be very important. Women voters are very important today. Young voters are going to be very, very important. You can't insult those people. We are a party of addition, not a party of subtraction. And I think to a certain extent, the Trump started the downhill derogatory trashing his fellow. And it's now the world we live in. It's the social media. You know, you couldn't send a press release out saying this guy's a fat idiot and get it printed. You can put it in a tweet. It's now put in a tweet with 15,000 other people retweeting it. Cable television, which I've been a part of for many, many years, is also very much a driving force in all of this. We had too many good candidates start the thing, so you've got these big, gigantic debates, and obviously people, 24 million people watch a debate, means there's a great interest, but they also make a judgment very quickly. And some candidates are better debaters, some people are better governing process. And we've eliminated a whole bunch of people that I think are very talented and should have been in the game. I think we're down to four forces at this point in time. Obviously, Trump and Trump supporters are not going to go away. I don't think he makes it, but he's going to be. Carson is for all practical purposes, gone. Cruz is the conservative, hard right, conservative, very bright man, very polarizing man, and I think to a certain extent is going to be a credible candidate as he was in Iowa. A very strong organization, believes in the grassroots and was very effective. I think Rubio is the young, conservative, articulate. I think to a certain extent he's becoming more and more the hope of a lot of people. Is a great message, probably the closest to Reagan of anybody, young Reagan. Moving very quickly up in New Hampshire. And then there's a fourth group that's there that's not have a name, and that's the anti-Trump group. And whoever, and what Trump doesn't understand, for every voter he has is three voters he doesn't have. And so there's a large segment of money people and what have you that are going to basically try and find an alternative. I think the governors probably that are left, Bush and Kasich and Christie, probably get wiped out in New Hampshire. And I think New Hampshire will end up Rubio's on the move. He probably comes in second at a minimum. Trump left the state today, which is a bad thing to do in New Hampshire because they don't make up their mind till the last day. He flew to South Carolina. He may make it back for the debate, but it's snowing up there. Trump may win it, but I think as we go south, you'll see a real battle between if one of the governors gets fourth or fifth, they may stay in the race a while. Bush will have some more money. But, you know, and Jeb Bush is a very fine man. But run probably the worst campaign I've ever seen in my life. You know, he had $100 million. He chased out Romney, spent $70 million, and gone from 20 points to 3 points, including in his home state, where his two-term governor, very popular, he's down to 4 points. So I don't imagine he stays around to Florida. John Kasich is a very able guy, been a friend of mine for many, many years, probably the most capable, smartest guy on the stage, does not suffer fools well. And he's on the stage with a bunch of fools, and he expresses it every time he's on there, makes faces, walks off the whole bit. And he's a great one-on-one interviewer. He's a great retail politician. He's been a great governor and may end up surviving and be on the ticket, whatever that ticket may be. But this is not a race I would have predicted a year ago, but I think that's where it is today.
We could have used that $70 million here at Eureka College. I'm just saying. Ladies and gentlemen, please help me thank and give our gratitude to Ed Rollins.
Thank you. pleasure.
Thank you.
Are you giving me jelly beans? I got 14 tons of jelly beans.
You can have jelly beans if you want, but I've got something, and this is actually the first time we've ever done this.